In the meantime, we haven't finished business to attend, meeting the existing MDGs. Actually, we have a great deal of which we can be proud, but we are not there yet. So we will continue to press hard right up to the 2015 deadline, especially in countries and sectors that are most off the track. This will require both smart policy making and adequate financing to back the policy making up. Our public consultation revealed a widespread understanding that providing aid continues to be important in helping partner countries achieve their 2015 and post-2015 targets. At the same time, it is true that other factors, including remittances, growth-friendly policies and trade, will have a role to play in bringing about a fairer distribution of resources across developed and developing worlds. And the European Union understands only too well that aid alone will not solve our development problems. That's why, for instance, while doubling its collective aid in real terms since 2000, the EU has been committed to assisting its partner countries in other ways. Hence, for example, it is also the main importer of developing country exports and the only major economy to give duty and quota-free access to least developed countries. And we must maintain these commitments. We must maintain and promote our core European values, both at home and abroad. And we must demonstrate to EU citizens and taxpayers at the same time that the large amounts we spend on development assistance are producing maximum possible results. So it's not just input that matters, amounts that you put here and there. It's really results that matter. How our support helps to transform the societies for the better. We must do this whatever the economic weather. But in the current climate, it is more important than ever. And I am pleased to see us performing in this area. The EU is widely recognized by independent bodies as a very effective donor. The Publish What You Fund watchdog has singled the European Commission out for a leading on aid transparency internationally and internally, and has ranked it among the top 5 most transparent donors in the world. So there is widespread understanding among fellow aid practitioners that the European Union brings clear added value to development cooperation. In short, that EU aid works. EU aid groups back EU development funding as among the world's best and would like to see it maintained in the EU's next 7-year financial framework to take us up to 2020. For me, being among the world's best is a great news, but it should not dent our desire to deliver even better value for money. We must constantly strive to do better. The world is changing fast, and we cannot afford to be left behind. Instead, as I suggested at the beginning of my speech, we must demonstrate that the trust which partner countries and fellow donors like the United Nations have in us is well placed. We must be ready to be global leaders and help shape the new world order. An outward-looking Europe with adequate financial means, promoting its values and interests, and taking an active political role in global governance can deliver real added value and meet the ambitions set out for its external action and development policy in the Lisbon Treaty. That's why the Commission's proposals for the next financial framework include increased funding for an external relations package, which reflects the new international context and the need for greater
impact and results from external spending. The proposed amounts would contribute to the EU's formal collective commitment to meet the long-standing target and set aside 0.7% of our gross national income as official development assistance by 2050, and would thus be a decisive step towards achieving the MDGs. And they would be supporting the principles and instruments we need for a new development policy that is at once more effective, more transparent, and more outcomes-oriented. A policy that seeks greater aid effectiveness, policy coherence, and donor coordination. A policy of the kind that I believe we can all sign up to. Ladies and gentlemen, as we pursue the MDGs and at the same time look ahead to a post-MDGs world, our central concern should be that fight against poverty is by no means won. We need first and foremost to listen carefully, both to the experiences of those who have succeeded and to the aspirations of those who haven't. The process that we embark on now will make all the difference to the end result. We need to consider how the outcomes and follow-up of RioPlus20 and other international processes should feed into final agenda that everyone can embrace. With the agenda for change, I believe we have the right policy directions in place to be able to contribute to this global agenda. And with a sound financial framework in place to take us up to 2020, we will be able to set about meeting our development goals in earnest. For the European Union to play an active role in the global debate on development post-2050, we need partners like you, as truly representative organizations, to continue providing us with your input, as you have done through the public consultation, and more broadly speaking, through the structured dialogue and this successor forum. Furthermore, your work to support governance and development for all in the EU's partner countries around the world will be a vital means of support for our agenda for change and further means of enabling our partnership to take root. We share the noble ambition of giving the world's poorest and most vulnerable a real chance to escape the spiral of poverty and insecurity and participate in society to the best of their ability. That ambition must be at the heart of the post-2015 agenda. That's the thinking part. In the meantime, however, there is plenty for us all to be doing as well. Thank you very much for your kind attention.